大学传统音乐系的老师与同学，大家好，我是张璇，我目前在美国印第安纳音乐院的历史时代风格演艺所教授大键琴、古钢琴还有音乐即兴。那这个历史时代风格演艺的中文翻译的确有点长，所以我今天会分为三个部分为大家做介绍，每一个部分大约30分钟。由于这堂课无法与各位直接互动，所以在讲座开始前，希望可以麻烦各位在 Google 表单上面填入您的思考，这样做一些简单的回馈给我。那这个 Google 表单可以由这个 link 或是 QR code 下载。那在大家准备下载的同时呢，我先做一些简单的介绍。历史时代风格演绎，它的英文称为 Historical Informed Performance。那 Historical Informed Performance 它是大约盛行于1980年代在美国跟欧洲所掀起的一股复古风潮，英文简称为 HIP HIP。 准备好了吗？那我们先来看一段由美国旧金山巴洛克乐团所制作的一个简短的介绍影片，影片时长大约7分钟。那在观看影片的同时，也请同学随时上 Google 表单分享您的想法与看法。那这些想法与看法可以是包括对于没有声音资料下面历史背景如何做考证，还有时代与风格对于演奏有多么重要，或者是身为当代的我们如何演绎传统之类之类的想法。那我们先来看影片咯。
What is hip?
What is hip?
So what is hip?
What is hip?
What is hip?
What is hip? It's like the old song, What is hip? When you're really hip, it don't even show.
So what is hip? It's historically informed performance.Based on the study of musical sources that aims to recreate the stylistic characteristics of the period in which the music was performed using period instruments and performance practices.
Now we can't be exactly historically informed. We don't preserve Bach in a bottle, but we can get the instruments of the period.We have the knowledge, perhaps, of how fast something went. If it was based on a dance piece, we know how the dances went because we have people who can still do them. It's still performance for a modern audience. Our job is to use the knowledge we have to give the best and most lively and most moving performance we possibly can.
It is essentially trying to perform music of the past in a way that we think it may have sounded like when it was new.We study why a piece was written, for whom, where it was played. And we use all of that as sort of ingredients to bake a musical cake that we think is true to the intention of the composer, time and place that the piece was originally heard.
It's approaching a piece of music using the historical and musical context of the time.The instruments they would have used, the performance techniques they would have used.
Crucially, for a lot of people, it led them to want to play it on the old instruments. For the same reason that, you know, if you want to sculpt like Bernini, you've got to get yourself a chisel.
You study manuscripts, you look at the original bowings, maybe different variations of the piece that the composer.Changed as he went along, and you try to stay really true to the way it would have been played.
It's to look at the violin partitas and sonatas that Bach wrote in his own handwriting and say, huh, what kind of bowings did he do? It's being ready for a big, huge discussion, wonderful discussion about what we have at our hands to read and look at and how that could possibly affect our music making.
One of the things that's true about a period instrument orchestra is it's much more like a jazz band than a modern orchestra. There's an awful lot that we play that isn't written down. people are expected to improvise. The harpsichord is expected to improvise, so is the lute player. The composers of the 18th century wrote just the bare bones of what they needed. They didn't write the dynamics necessarily, the getting louder, the getting softer, all that stuff we just have to put in.
You don't see this as much in symphony orchestra concerts where they're sitting there and they're playing the heck out of that symphony and it sounds amazing, but you don't get as much of that lift. But then you go to an early music concert and all of us are, you know, jumping around and bopping along to the music. And I've even, you know, played concerts and people will come up afterwards and be like, I used to hate Telemann, and then you guys played it and it makes so much more sense.
Students who are interested in historical performance tend to enjoy the freedom that it provides to put their own voice into the music in a way that a member of a huge symphony orchestra just can't.
A modern orchestra uses many of the same instruments that a period instrument orchestra does, but they've been modernized. We take those instruments and take them back to how they were made. The sounds sometimes are a little subtler, the instruments don't have as much metal in them, and we also use instruments like harpsichords, lutes, which are designed for a more intimate experience.
I was a conservatory student, actually getting ready to do a master's degree on modern cello in Boston, and heard this and knew my path. Absolutely knew my path. The whole journey of gut strings and instrument that was less stressed and more about resonance and about color and shapes.
When I would play on modern cello, when I would play a Bach suite, for example, it sounded great. You know, it was a big, loud, resonant sound, but it just didn't allow you to make these kind of fine details. And a lot of the joy of playing it on Baroque cellos, you can really just very easily get a very quiet, very small, precise articulation.
I feel this kind of music in my body. You know, it's a whole really fluid thing. It's really rewarding because the sound is so live. So you just have to be a lot more conscious and a lot more engaged with the string to.
The real beauty from, I think, all of these instruments come is from the vast variety in color within a single note. That kind of arch to the sound is the true difference between the Baroque and the modern oboe.
I think it's great when we try to get back to see possibly how it might have been played in their day. We'll never know. It's not preserved in amber. We don't have a famous singer's larynx in a bottle. We can't tell. But we can get close and we can have a very good time doing it. And we hope bring some of this old music back to life.
那看完影片后，麻烦同学分享 Google 表单上第二个问题：历史时代风格演绎与您的艺术领域是否有所连结呢？刚刚那个影片其实是简单的科普介绍，今天讲座主题历史时代风格演绎与台湾当代音乐类型的融合分享，将做深入的探讨。Historical informed performance 常常见中间的 inform 这个字被省略。那之前这堂讲座的题目是以英文的字面翻译为历史考证，但在这一年的时间越深入探讨，越觉得 HIP 的研究方法或许对于台湾的音乐类型有参考价值，因此目前正在将各地的俗称作为整理，依照乐器形制、文化背景与音乐的内容，将 Historical Informed Performance 翻译为历史时代风格演绎，简称为历史演绎法。为什么这么复杂呢？因为世界各地目前没有统一的中文翻译， 香港呢依照英国的名称 Ancient Music 翻译为建古演奏，那在日本呢称为时代演奏法。另外常常见台湾的音乐会演简介中将 Period Performance 翻译为时代演绎法，或与 Authentic Performance 统称为复古演奏。台湾有一群留欧洲的音乐家翻译为欧洲古乐或者是早期音乐，而在美国发展的知识概念不同于英国与欧陆把这样子的音乐类型归类为趋向于传统的导向，而是建构了一个严谨的研究方法，着重当代实践与历史传统，并且重视音乐在文化上面的表现层面。那为什么会这么复杂呢？我们要从它的背景开始说起。大约在1970年复古风潮开始的初期呢，它其实是对于19世纪后期所建构的音乐院教育只注重演奏的技巧但不重音乐内涵的一种反动。那这个复古的风潮就是希望回到人本时期的全人的训练，音乐家除了会演奏他还要会作曲，他还要会音乐学分析。那这样的时期从中世纪一直到19世纪中期，包括文艺复兴、巴洛克、18世纪古典时期以及早期浪漫乐派，这段大约到1850年第一次工业革命结束为止，以手工制作乐器的时期。换言之，就是第一次工业革命后产业分工越来越精细，那手工制作的乐器呢，它是针对地区与时代的多样需求性而客制化的，但是工业革命之后就变成工厂化，比较是大量的然后固定的一个形制。那由于历史演绎的研究运用了多重史料，涵盖多学门领域还有多面向范畴，他思考的严谨程度还有证据力频繁的受到各领域学者的挑战。那这样的建构历程乃是从20世纪后半至21世纪的今天各界持续激烈讨论的议题。那这样的一个新兴学门的特殊语义呢，在知识建构的时间累积下，以各式各样我们刚刚讲的名称呈现，像早期音乐、欧洲古乐、时代演绎法、建古演奏、历史时代风格演绎法这些东西等。所以历史演绎的思维方式明显的弥补了19世纪后期建构的音乐乐教育体系缺乏但是需要的东西，并且更是迫切的回应了音乐传统在时代变迁下需要做的义务。对这样特殊的音乐语义的需求，在持续半个世纪的潮流推动下面，使得美国和欧洲的相关组织与教学机构陆续在2010年到2015年结合了各种的论述跟语汇，提出了清楚的论述还有上述的命名方式。那在美国发展的知识概念不同于欧洲跟英国，他们是趋向这个东西是我们的传统音乐，所以才会叫做欧洲古乐。而是美国呢，它是建构了一个严谨的研究方法，着重当代的实践还有历史的传统之间的关系，并且重视音乐在文化上面的表现。那讲座要分为三个部分，第一个部分呢就是历史时代风格演绎深入的中文的内涵定义，第二个部分就是与当代台湾音乐类型融合的时候有什么样的相关联处，还有在听觉认知的问题上面有什么样的议题需要解决，第三件事情就是音乐即兴。那 historical informed performance 以一句话来说，它就是根据考证历史证据，并且以时代乐器演奏来重建过去某一个时期的音乐风格。那我们把历史、时代、风格、演绎这四个部分分开来做解释。历史证据呢，指的是在音乐历史考证中使用的作曲家手稿、作曲家信件，或者是新闻报纸。那历史证据呢，同样的也存在当时的音乐理论分析，还有音乐。历史证据呢，也存在当时的文学画作、艺术、哲学。换句话说，这里面的每一幅图都有相对应的多重领域、项目，还有议题，包括音乐家的社会的地位，还有民间的文化，甚至呢，还有音乐相对应的哲学跟精神医学上面的问题。在17、18世纪的时候，那时候的医学还没有走到脑部，所以医学其实都是在讲神经，意思就是我们在演奏乐器的其实反应不是经过大脑的思考，而是经过我们这个里面呢有那个液体神经液体的反应。 所以在医学记录上面有几件很好玩的事情，就是有一些男人啊，他会把女人就是想要离婚，但是就是找理由，就是说他演奏乐器演奏太多了，所以产生了精神疾病，所以医生就帮他开诊疗单，就说对他有精神疾病，所以就离婚，然后把这个女人送到精神病院去。那这个例子还蛮常见的。那或者是说他把羊的舌头拉出来啊，然后去刺羊舌头的不一样部分，看羊被刺这个部分的时候是脚抬起来还是哪里抬起来，他们是来促进了神经的反应。当这个东西理论医学理论下去的时候，对演奏就产生了非常不一样的思考的逻辑方式。那历史时代风格演绎呢，讲到刚刚它是以历史证据和时代乐器演奏重建过去某一个时期的音乐风格的时代，它便是代表过去某一个时代，而相对应时代的乐器就称为时代乐器，英文为 period instrument。例如大家以为说只有大键琴，可是其实那个时候也有一个小键琴叫做 clavicle， 它具代表性的时代是文艺复兴时期早期还有巴洛克早期时期。那大键琴呢，它具代表性的时期其实是巴洛克时期中晚期。时代乐器也可以代表某个地区在某个时代的乐器，例如 fiddle 跟 violin 它同样是翻译为提琴，但是在美国呢， Fiddle 它指的是用在爱尔兰、苏格兰、法国的传统音乐后裔风格的小提琴音乐，例如在阿巴拉契亚山脉的民间音乐、蓝草乡村音乐、卡韵流行音乐等。因此以时代乐器演奏某个时代的风格则称为时代演绎法。那这里需要加强解释的就是演绎的绎是言部的绎，而不是密部的绎。如果我们看一下来自国家教育研究院的中文翻译，演绎密部的绎，它其实呢是一种纯粹的推理方法，要求前提是结论兼备有必然性可推的关系。那举例来说，就是说我们从原理中演绎出一个数学的公式。所以演绎呢，它是分析跟推算的一个过程 analyze， 然后或者是去先建立一个结论。可是呢，我们作为一个演绎的这个绎应该是言部的绎，它代表在音乐上并不只是运用历史证据推理分析与推算，它更是将作曲家使用的文字符号和风格以演奏诠释传达陈述传达给听众，有点像是翻译的译跟口译的译都是言部的译。那 historical informed performance 根据历史证据与时代乐器重建过去每一个时期的音乐风格，这个风格呢，他在讲的就是以语义跟知度。语义这个词呢，它代表在音乐表现中以具有说服力与沟通性能力的音乐修辞来呈现语法跟句法，英文称作 rhetoric。 我们知道文艺复兴时期的政治家他一定要是很能言善道的演说家，所以在文艺复兴跟巴洛克的音乐的表现，他其实认为音乐的表现方法是跟演说是一样的，它不只是弹了让自己开心而已，它是有功能性，要传达不管是一个情绪或是一个想法或是一个概念，要传达给听众清楚的表现。语义呢，它也代表了说同样我们听到的音 Do Re Mi Fa So Do Re Mi Fa So， 它在法国的表现，法国的语法表现的方法跟德国的表现的语法是不一样的。法国的语文我们知道常常句尾的后面最后一个母音会跟句首同一个头的这个子音会相联合，所以 Do Re Mi Fa So Do Re Mi Fa So Do Re Mi Fa So Do Re Mi Fa So， 它会连续下去的。在意大利的语义就是 Do Re Mi Fa So Do Re Mi Fa So Do Re Mi Fa So， 清楚有节拍系的，这跟它的语法也是有关系的。德国他就会注重他的乐句要怎么结束 Do Re Mi Fa So Do Re Mi Fa So， 就是所以这个语义呢，从除了地域性的不同，作曲家也有不同的语义， 那同一个作曲家呢，他在早期、中期、晚期、时期的语义也会使用的不一样。同学们很好奇，刚刚以上所讲的这些东西在西乐的训练里面不是一直都有吗？为什么在1970年代的时候居然会有一个风潮跳出来要讲这些东西呢？那实际上呢，19世纪后期所建构的音乐院教育体系，它就真的是缺乏这样子的一个内涵。我自己亲身就碰到音乐系的教授跟我说，我们演奏组的都已经没有时间在练够曲目了，不管是钢琴或是小提琴啊，那还谁还有时间跟你去深究巴洛克音乐啊，讲的语义，作曲家法国德国跟意大利这些东西都不同，大家练技巧都已经来不及了。可是有没有想过，这其实就是个问题。我再分享一个，就是朗朗的音乐会。我们在这边的朗朗在结婚之前有来我们这边开过几场音乐会，我的印象非常深刻。两场音乐会结束之后，所有的钢琴主修的学姐啊、教授，隔一天都非常非常的忧郁。怎么说？朗朗的音乐会的精确程度是真的是到99%。在音乐会中，你拿谱下来对作曲家的原版的谱，你会发现它的渐强跟渐弱，就是在作曲家写的那一颗音下面，哪一颗音下面的渐弱是结束，它就真的是在那一颗音结束，它的精准度准度达到99%。但是音乐会完，这只是个人的想法，并不觉得音乐感动。所以我们就开始去反思这样的问题，我们在练这些东西就是要达到这样的精准度，我们要达到精看的技巧，可是为什么我们看到了一个例子是当达到了这样子的一个境界之后却不感动人。那所以呢，这个东西呢，就是在讲到说我们练音乐的目的是什么，我们把我们的青春年华最花样的宝贵的时间都投资在一个技巧上面，这真的是一个是值得探讨的议题。所以另外一个就是语义为什么重要，像在欧洲比赛的时候，拿巴哈的音乐比赛来说好了，今天不管你这是俄国，你在拿小提琴大赛第一名的，或是你在哪里拿大赛第一名的，你到巴哈的音乐比赛的时候，我们要看的是你的风格、你的诠释，还有你的语义。很有趣，德国、法国或者是意大利或日本人弹同样一首巴哈的曲子，你绝对不会听到一模一样的东西，一定有他自己的语言跟语义在，还有你可以听得到他对这首曲子他的诠释的定义在，绝对不会100%一样，绝对不会，而且会非常清楚各国的一个风格。那有些的像我就遇到有一个俄国的音乐家，他是拿俄国很年轻17岁就大赛第一名，他去找评审抗议说为什么我第一轮就被刷下来了，然后评审就说因为这不是小提琴比赛，这是巴哈比赛，巴哈音乐，请问你知道巴哈音乐的内涵吗？请问你知道你弹的那首曲子它的tempo marking 是什么意思吗？所以为什么每一件事情都要解释的这么清楚？为什么历史时代风格演绎这件事要解释的那么清楚，和我们有什么关系？实际上呢，身为音乐演奏者，我们必须要非常清楚自己是谁，我有什么东西，我有什么样的背景跟文化跟内涵。所以历史时代风格演绎呢，是对于研究传统建构的一个方式跟方法。那这个历史时代风格演绎呢，为什么会与当代台湾音乐类型要融合呢？它其实是有一个交流的背景，就是意大利皮查威尔蒂戏剧院的制作人原来是想要借由美国印第安纳University 跟台湾做一个融合。他们之前在不丹跟日本都有做了成功的制作，融合的制作。那所以呢，我的交流计划呢，就是先来做一个田野调查，还有看看是不是有可能我们把这样的知识能够融合建构起来。那我们在第一部分讲座结束之前，先来看一下他们在不丹的融合影片，接下来会进到第二部分，再讨论跨领域跟跨文化，还有听觉认知的内容。那看影片咯。
In August of 2013, I got an email inviting me to film the first opera ever to be staged in the Kingdom of Bhutan. Bhutan is a small, mysterious, landlocked country in South Asia, nestled in the Himalayas between India and China. The government had been looking for ways of carefully opening Bhutan to Western culture, but in a way that respected its own traditions, and that's how this project was born. The opera was George Friedrich Handel's Acis and Galatea, but the plan was to incorporate Bhutanese song, dance, instrumentation, and visual arts. I was invited thanks to an extreme form of nepotism. You see, my great-great-great-great-great-great-grandfather was Handel's patron when he came to Italy in the early 1700s. The organizers of the project thought it would be fun to reunite Handel and the Ruspoli family after 300 years in the Himalayas. The project reminded me a bit of Werner Herzog's film, Fitzcarraldo, in which this mad rubber baron, played by Klaus Kinski, becomes obsessed with bringing opera to the jungles of South America. The opportunity was too much to resist, so I took the 3-day journey from Los Angeles to Bhutan, and this is what I saw there.
A pioneering project of bringing opera to Bhutan for the very first time.
The mad idea was to combine Acis and Galatea by Handel with the Bhutanese culture.
Steph thought, why don't I set this 400-year-old Handel opera in 1914 in Bhutan as a visiting party? And so the concept brings Westerners into the Bhutanese culture in a very naive and in a very new context.
When we suggested this title to our Bhutanese friends, it's a plot that speaks of love, jealousy, death, and transformation. It sounded very familiar to them. That was quite extraordinary because these two cultures, Western cultures of Handel, of Western theater, with this other extremely deep and profound culture, seems to be very, very distant. Instead, we find so many contacts, so many links together.
The opera we chose is Handel's Acis and Galatea, the story about the ultimate triumph of compassion over anger, ignorance, and greed, which here in Bhutan are the three poisons that are the cause of all suffering.
It was wonderful. It was just out of this world. Everybody enjoyed it. And the mixture between the Bhutanese and the Western culture was so well done.